Thanks for your company, folks. Leading the news this hour. And a warning, viewers may find some of this vision distressing. It is. This is the moment a plane carrying 132 people nosedived in a mountainous area in China's southeast. Rescuers on the scene searching for survivors in what has been described as the country's worst air disaster in nearly a decade. Look, there's not much left, let's be honest. Nine correspondent Alison Petrowski is following the story. Ali, what more do we know?
Yeah, look, it is tough to watch. Good morning to you, Carl. It was 2:38 p.m. local time when that plane, the China Eastern Flight 5735, nosedived into the mountainside in remote southern China. Onlookers capturing those terrifying final moments, Carl, and also capturing the aftermath, those flames, that forest along the mountainside lighting up when that crash hit. It's not clear what caused this disaster, but let's hear from aviation expert Ron Barsh.
This is a really, really unusual event because it happened in the middle of the day. The weather didn't seem to be a problem. And what's most extraordinary is that there was no mayday call.
Carl, there were 132 people on that flight, 123 passengers, 9 staff. We have seen pictures of family and colleagues finding out the news at the airport, awaiting for their friends and family to arrive on that flight. Search conditions are not good at the moment, Carl. Emergency crews really hampered by poor accessibility given the remote region that it's in, and also poor visibility thanks to some bad weather conditions. Carl, this was a Boeing 737-800. It was not a Boeing 737 MAX, which is, of course, those planes that have had issues and been involved in deadly crashes in the past. This was a regular Boeing 737-800. It is the most popular commercial aircraft in the world. China Eastern says it is suspending its fleet and grounding it for the moment while it investigates, Carl.
Just awful for those families. Awful. Ali, thank you.
Well, turning to the situation in Ukraine, and Russian forces occupying the Ukrainian city of Kherson have opened fire on peaceful protesters as Vladimir Putin steps up his assault on the country. Nine correspondent Amelia Adams is in Lviv and has more.
Well, as we got to air, a 35-hour curfew has been imposed across the capital as Kyiv comes under heavy bombardment. The latest airstrike, an horrific attack on a shopping centre which gutted the building, wrecked nearby buildings and killed at least 8 people. Authorities expect that death toll will rise. President Zelensky using a national address to demonstrate the sound that's really become normal for cities across this country. The sound of air raid sirens, now for 25 days, sending people running to shelters, fearing for their lives. And horrific scenes today in the southern city of Kherson. Russian occupiers opened fire on local protesters, Putin's troops using gunfire and stun grenades to disperse the crowd. Reports several people were injured. US President Joe Biden and European leaders have just spoken by phone to discuss the diplomatic efforts to reach a ceasefire, but so far it is a stalemate here. Negotiations between Moscow and Ukraine continue daily to no avail. Neither side willing to concede on key points which could end the fighting.
Senator Kimberly Kitching's husband has taken aim at the Labor Party during an emotional eulogy at her funeral. Take a listen.
There's a lot I could say about the unpleasantness of a cantankerous cabal, not all of them in Parliament, that was aimed at Kimber. She deserves so very much better.
Federal politics reporter Fiona Whelan has this story. Fee, good morning to you. He says Kimberly deserved better.
Alex, this would have been uncomfortable listening to for some because the 3 senators accused of bullying Kimberly Kitching were actually sitting in the church as her husband took aim. Penny Wong, Christina Keneally and Katie Gallagher have all denied claims that they ostracised her before she died of a suspected heart attack. And look, Andrew Landau said he didn't blame any one person or meeting for her death, but added her friends and ferociously loyal staff are angry about how she was treated. This morning, Independent Senator Jackie Lambie has weighed in.
Those other 3 women on the sidelines, they've been really ostracised in the last week. There's not just one woman's death that we're looking at here now. There's 3 other women out there hurting greatly from these accusations and everything else.
News Corp is reporting the opposition leader has now pledged to review the Labor Party complaints process and will honour Senator Kitching with an award in her name at every national conference. But so far, Anthony Albanese has resisted calls for an internal inquiry into what went on. Alex?
All right, Fee, thank you. To breaking news out of Sydney, this is a live shot of a man suspended from a pole in Port Botany. He is protesting against climate change. There he is there. Police are currently working to get him down. Traffic is heavy, with commuters warned to take an alternate route.
He looks kind of comfortable.
Yeah. He'd be a bit further up the pole by now, but anyway.
I don't know how it helps the cause when you just completely and utterly ruin people's drive to work and stuff. I mean,
they're not going to invoke sympathy, are you?
Just none.
Yeah.
You know, it's just ridiculous.
I'll get that sorted soon, I'd say.
They will. Mm-hmm. Queensland will be front and centre of a new tourism campaign, with Scott Morrison set to make the announcement in Cairns today. Mia Glover is on the Gold Coast. Mia, good morning to you. It's a multi-million dollar cash splash on an awful day there on the Goldie.
Oh, yeah, isn't it a shocker here, Carl? It really is bad. But no, yes, around $60 million will be poured into the tourism industry right across the country in a bid to lure back those international tourists sooner rather than later. A lot of it will be spent on marketing initiatives to emphasise those smaller and regional tourism hotspots, like here on the beautiful Goldie, as well as in Cairns, also in New South Wales, like the South Coast and the Hunter Valley region. Like you say, though, Carl, we're waking up on an awful day here at Burleigh this morning. We've been speaking to a few runners about what they think of this announcement.
I just think it's an election ploy, to be quite honest. That's all. Yeah. All the pollies, that's all they're doing.
Yeah. Not coming from the heart, you don't think?
No, couldn't care less.
I work at the airport, so we did it pretty tough down there. I don't know if 60 million is enough, though.
Lots of mixed reactions there, Carl, but I tell you what, all we need to show international tourists is pictures like this, and they'll come soon, don't you reckon?
Yeah, I think you're right about that. That's pretty good. Thanks, Mia.
A previously healthy 2-year-old child in Sydney has died after contracting COVID-19. The toddler was rushed to hospital on Wednesday night and passed away on Friday. Infectious diseases expert Professor Peter Collignon says parents shouldn't panic.
Children are much lower risk than their parents, for instance, and particularly their grandparents. But it shows we need to do everything we can to decrease our personal risk, and particularly that means through vaccination for those who can get vaccines.
There is currently no COVID vaccine for children under the age of 5. Well, some breaking news now, and tickets for Shane Warne's state memorial will be made available this afternoon as Australia prepares to farewell the King of Spin. Let's go live to Isabel Stashkovsky at the MCG for us. Good morning again, Iza. What more do we know?
Sarah, more details have been locked in for the memorial that will, of course, be held here at the MCG. The service will start at 7 p.m. on March 30 and last for about 2 hours, with gates open to the public from around 5:30. Those tickets for the public, as you say, will be available from today at 3 p.m. via the Ticketek website, and, of course, they will all be free. There will be some seating reserved as well for family, for friends, for guests and some invited dignitaries, while the family of Shane Warne has asked instead of flowers for donations to be made to the Florey Institute of Neuroscience and Mental Health for anyone who won't be able to attend but would still like to participate. Also, Sarah, the entire service is going to be live streamed on the Victorian Department website.
Yeah, I think a lot of people will be paying their respects. Thanks, Iza.